John Banville, the novelist, says that you should always write against the grain of where your life is at the minute, so that when your life is in disarray, it's not a good time to be exploring disorder in your fiction, and that when you're happiest, you're best able to plunge the depths, I suppose. So I think I must have been extraordinarily happy when I wrote this book, because it's quite dark, but this poem is perhaps less so. I'm kind of talking about Ian Deftinen. Does anybody know who Deftinen was in Irish mythology? Máthair Cúchulainn. Deftinen was Cúchulainn's mother, but we don't hear about her all that much. And I was thinking, you often hear people wondering, maybe feminist critics wonder, you know, Shakespeare's sister, and she was equally talented, would she have become as formidable and would she be permitted to become as great a writer as him? And I was thinking about this idea in an Irish context and thinking, you know, what if Cúchulainn's mother had a daughter equally prone to destructive behaviour? And then I was driving home from Galway one day and I saw her. I saw Cúchulainn's mother. There was this girl coming from a camogie match, and it was clear by her expression that the final whistle had sounded just a little bit too early for all of her destructive appetites to have been properly expressed. There was her face was blazing with fury, and she had a big cut on the side of her face, and the hurley certainly looked the worse for wear. And I was thinking, what if Cúchulainn gets his name from disemboweling a dog who was really doing nothing except what his master told him to do? And it occurred to me that if Cúchulainn's mother had a daughter, it wouldn't have gone any better with the dog. So that's the background to this poem. There's another story about the poem, which is that when it was published first, a man wrote to me from Cork to say I'll read the poem first and you'll be able to judge them with a better story, because I was unjustly accused or not, but here we go. In Ian Deftinen. Er vorn fishtein uwen ta kain fiun me shuwe ton paia. Might have been shoige, shillo on live, for heeske is an lucker, a reek in her thaw or haven. Ha mount mars kors an aime kriene, is mark da rare er ruwe an all. Fyrt na himmerhe an asool, is a cromon for kastas a tool, le bashan cromon, a dors an chwin in a black. Dirt for fwil, a chadukashi for fadle, le kosher tolle. Decht in his daughter, on Newcastle Road, a fair-haired girl is walking towards town, an ash stick swinging in her hand, easy as the lock of hair dancing on her forehead. As you'd expect, there's a nick in the seasoned wood, another in the girl's cheek, the fire of combat blazing in her eyes. Her hip bones jut and angle, turned like the blade of a hurley that blew unexpectedly in her fist. Blood will be spilt when she arrives at Cúchulainn's feast. So this man wrote to me to say he was putting together an anthology of songs and poems about exploits of footballers and hurlers from Cork, and would I mind if he included this poem? I'd never been so flattered in my whole life, and I wrote back and said that I could think of nothing better, and was honoured and all of the rest of it. And then I heard nothing, and a couple of months later he wrote to say that a mature reflection, he thought that perhaps this was not the correct kind of poem to include in an anthology of poems celebrating noble and heroic feats, because he said, there's a suggestion in your poem that this girl is engaged in something ignoble and unheroic. And he said, I know that as a figure of speech only, we used to say before we took to the pitch, that we leave no stone unturned, and if blood had to be spilt, it would be spilt, but it was only a figure of speech, he said, and therefore the poem. It has been, all I can say is that Cork haven't won anything since then. Leonard Hallgon, him, the Hale, I guess, a Nasco Kosho, a Nask Indier for Shahe, the Shanastroil, Rivin and Sop, Shkrivne Don, my other Voss, and Hanavar. I guess more than Donna Street, but on the dos ma hen avaher mar a solia gome agus me hoch me in a dish mar a vina nor a fwrs nun nor a fwrs I bos mi me gyrig me hen for her nesim of rog a fein mar a vis nor a fwrs I bos I'd written a poem about 20 years before this about I suppose our own first encounter with death and for all of my brothers and my grandparents came to live with us and my grandmother died in the house and when I wrote the poem I was in my late 20s and I was trying to write it from the perspective of the 8-year-old child I was when she died. And I wrote these two poems 20 years later when I realised that I had now arrived at an age closer to my father's, when his parents died, I was closer to him than I was to myself as the young child who had remembered this occasion in the earlier poem. And so in these two poems I tried to imagine the same, but I actually tried to imagine it was not my grandmother's death. As soon as she died, my grandfather went back to their own house to die, and he died a couple of months later, which is clearly what he wanted. So I was trying to, in this poem, I'm trying to imagine myself in my father's shoes, waiting for the brother to come later. You know, what the changes in technology is going to be the most frightening thing in the world, the phone or even worse, the doorbell ringing at 3 o'clock in the morning. So, that's what these two poems come from. And here do we're, like I said, here do we're. O reab, figin and dorish, cryptin and huin ne regan, is gomegan do eri, le turtfin, shis and mask na skoil, is na glob, nach godolin fwin. O dogshin vantage o li, dar hukshe, grog am stuin, is gomegan do an yishin, I ogant, I gyantar na hanara van dua, Rieve swihe, o begin do shasav, kos nocht, flesh hens of wucht. A geestuch de glor, chien, and tagger, or alish. A gubber, or a kaspach, ne farin, a treed. Gur eel, and thayn, a chansig, a shion, fado. The fokal frustra, is loyal, loyal, and gan duffer. O reabach, and fall, padruche, is fokal burro, grover, le toga, go atuhe, and da hair. Fall, and tiergur, the hair. Hold the ridger ear, the zoor shot, and the hachani, near Hubbage, a nail sucker, near Harry and Oil, the rag, Araba, Gomoro, Fuder, the Hushka, his rashtuch, the brishta, the veil, the dingle and the wish dawning, the dalas, the troy, the smut, the chasach, the bean, and the haggard, the muck, the harsh, the tail, the veil, the vanity, the tap, the quidding, and the dirish, the reish. From the moment the doorbell tore the curtain of his sleep, forcing him to get up and go down among the shadows and the clocks that never sleep. From the moment he left the warm woman to whom he gave unreasonable love and still had to leave behind in a world where breathing comes easy. Ever since he had to stand in bare feet on his own in the cold, listening to the gentle voice of the priest, telling him in a whisper shot through with the kindness of rain that he was dead. The one who subdued his terror long ago with hard words and strong hands that meant no harm. Since the wall of prayers and harsh love words they had built between them from both sides was levelled, a useless wall high as heaven they had built between them at this moment, he never slept or breathed easy, for fear the roar of blood and broken gusts from his mouth would drown out the engine of the car dying on the street outside. The gentle cough of the priest out there on the threshold of the world, his holy finger approaching the doorbell again. And Daonscoil, Maria, for me.